listening to the Classic Rock Podcast. Now, you can join us online at the website at www.theclassicrockpodcast.com for website-exclusive interviews, features, and videos with some of the best new talent and, of course, the genre's most legendary names. Now, you can also find us on Facebook at The Classic Rock Podcast and on Instagram as well. Now, this clip is taken from the feature with founder member of the Canadian band, one of their greatest exports, Triumph. Mike Levine joined us, and we look back at the very early days of how it all began for Triumph, the days when they used to test pyros in their garage, and the day they got their big, big break, when Sammy Hagar pulled out of a show and they stepped in, and from that moment on, they never looked back. So, Mike, Rock and Roll Machine, the biopic of Triumph, it is a remarkable story, well told, about three guys with a dream who begin with a plan of how they're going to make it. You got business acumen as well as the creative talent. And we see this story unfold. And what's a real pleasure about this is we don't actually see mention of drug abuse, alcohol abuse, wild parties, fortunes blown, mega divorces. You were all very well behaved.
Yes, sadly, sad but true. You know, we did have our moments now and then, but in general, you know, we were, I guess, for lack of a better way of saying it, that you know, when you're on the road, it's a grind and it's rough. And a three-piece band, you can't really mess up too much because you're going to let the other guys down. If one guy's not on, the whole band's not on.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, so we just lived by, okay, it's okay to have a few beers now and then. You know, have a beer during the drum solo. Maybe have two if he plays a long one. But that's about it.
Now, you guys were no musical amateurs. I mean, for you in particular, after Mother Lode, you came into Gil's band, Abernathy Shagnasters Wash and Wear Band, which is surely one of the greatest names for a band ever.
That's a dumbass name. I hated it. I only did it, as you watch the film, I did it as a favor to Gil.
It took him 10, would it take him 10 phone calls before you actually wavered and joined?
It just bugged the hell out of me. So, you know, it was fun. It was a part-time thing. It was only supposed to be 2 or 3 weeks, right? So,
you and him, though, did actually think about throwing in the towel at one stage, but decided to give it this one more shot. And this is where you went on the hunt for the guitar god.
Yeah, that's true. It's the idea of going running around with a, you know, 5 or 6 piece band, playing high schools on the weekends. It was fun for a part-time thing. But if we're going to get serious, then we had to get serious. So Gil and I sat down and said, "Do you want to get serious?" And we said, "Okay, let's give it a try." And so we brainstormed about how we would, our ideal band and what we would do, and you know, how it would all work out. And we said, "Okay, we're going to pack this other the old Abernathy thing. That's finished." You know, so. Then, like you say, we went on the hunt for the guitar god. And not easy to do. But it was not happy hunting. It was difficult hunting.
You ended up at this club watching this prog rock band called Act 3, and where you obviously went to see Rik Emmett. And I loved the bit about what made you make up your mind that he was the man. It was the moment that he did the flying V across the stage and his shoe flew off. And he carried on and didn't miss a beat.
It's true. You know, he was, we were pretty much knocked out with Rik. I remember Gil asking me, I'm flabbergasted how good he was. And, you know, Phil's a drummer, which is not really a musician in most people's minds. But he looks really good. He can sing really good. He said, but could he play a whole lot of love? Because the band was playing Gentle Giant and early Queen, those kind of did that kind of stuff. So I said, if he can play that, he can play a whole lot of love. You know, not to worry. Okay.
So what showed up actually was this business acumen and this business savvy that you had, because you go in and sit down to try and tempt him to join, you actually wave a check in front of him. You've actually got a check from a record company, Attic Records, and you're offering him, was it $175 a week to join? It seems incredible now. How did you convince a record company to give you an advance based on a promise?
It really wasn't that difficult. One of the partners at Attic Records was a friend of mine. We had known each other for a couple of years, and he was a former head of promotion for Warner Brothers Records in Canada. And I was involved with the record label. And so he let me travel the country with him. So when he threw a big party at the airport hotels for all the radio people and press people and whatever for Warner's, he let me tag along, and he introduced me to all these radio folks. So, you know, he was a good buddy, and he left Warner's and was a partner in Attic Records. So I took Tom to lunch and said, look, I got to create the world's greatest rock band. I got 2/3 of it now, and we did a record deal and some money. So he looked at me, said, are you serious? I said, yes, I am. And he said, okay, I'm in.
That was it. I love it. What a great story. Most bands, actually, at that stage, if they'd have picked up a check, would have perhaps gone out for the next 2 months and drank it or blown it on drugs and parties. But you being you, bought kit and lots of kit, and you had a big truck, and you'd be ferrying yourself around to the gigs in the locale and turning up with this, with a truck with your name on and everything. I mean, it was like you were thinking big right from the get-go.
Yeah, it's always the attitude is, you know, either go big or go home. And whatever we could afford to do, we did. And if it meant we didn't take paychecks, then we didn't take paychecks. But, you know, we started off small. You know, we had really amazingly lousy gear that we do, that was still pretty competitive for the level we were at, which was absolutely nowhere at that point. We're just starting out. But, you know, we just kept reinvesting into the band, you know, and we actually borrowed money. We went to the Toronto Musicians Credit Union and borrowed $10,000 from them.
I'm trying to conjure up a vision of you guys in your garage working on homemade pyros to take on the road with you. Were there any accidents?
Several. let's see. Well, there was one that the Gil was messing around with that stuff in his house, and he kind of blew out the big picture window at the front of the house. He didn't realize how much concussion there was in those things. So, and we were buying the flash powder. It was illegal to buy it. We had to get a license from the government to do it, from the Department of Mines and Natural Resources, to be able to buy the stuff. But so we got legal and figured out how to use it properly. But geez, Rick got burnt a couple of times. I got burnt once. Gil got burnt once. And after finally, we just said, we can't happen like this anymore. We built an absolutely foolproof, amazing pyro system. So we're on stage and, you know, there's a pyro cue coming up and there'd be these little red lights flashing. And then they come on knowing you have 5 seconds to get the hell out of the way and you're going to get blown up.
That's brilliant.
So after that, nothing bad really happened. Thank God.
Now, with all the great Cinderella stories, there's a break. And you get yours when Sammy Hagar pulls out of this radio premiere event down in San Antonio. And you just stepped in. And literally from that moment on, you know, that was it. You were off and running because that was, what, 5,000-seater? You played a blinding set. And then that was it. You were off on a little mini tour around the area. I mean, it must have been an incredible moment. Yeah, but big pressure.
It was big pressure. It was, we were playing on rented gear as well. You know, we had our guitars. And I think because we had to fly down, it made no sense to truck gear there because it was too far. And we went, what the hell, we'll just, you know, take what we can on a plane with us. And we took a few road cases, I think amp heads, and then we rented whatever we could rent, we needed to rent down there. And we walked on stage, and to say we were a little bit nervous, that would be an understatement. But, you know, we owned the audience from don't want it. It was amazing. It was just an amazing feeling. We're looking at each other like, is this for real or what? You know, well, guess what? You know, it taught us that we could play a big stage and be successful at doing it.
That was Mike Levine from Triumph. And for more from that feature and that interview, go to the website www.theclassicrockpodcast.com. And stay tuned for more great content coming soon. For the moment, though, from me, Tim Capel. Bye-bye for now.